Okay, so the title of my talk is, as was said a minute ago, Using MetaPost for Creating High-Quality Technical Graphics. And for those of you that don't know what MetaPost is, I'll tell you that in just a minute. The agenda is going to be, I'm going to tell you a little bit about MetaPost, give you an overview on graphics. I'm not up here claiming to be a graphics expert, but really just categorizing graphics into two classes and talk about each class, why you'd want one instead of the other. Give you some MetaPost fundamentals, jump right into MetaPost with some syntax, and I've got a MetaPost previewer that's analogous to this LaTeX previewer, and we'll actually try some code if time permits at the end. Some examples that I've done, obviously not nearly all that I've done. I've done so many of them, but I have quite a few examples that I've put together. How you include a MetaPost figure into a LaTeX document, probably an easy way to do it in tech too. I just don't know plain tech. I know LaTeX. Conversion to other formats, we'll discuss that, and then we'll have time for questions at the end. Okay, so what is MetaPost? Well, it's a programming language. This is Hobby. John Hobby is who developed MetaPost in 1992. He developed it to, it is a programming language, and the output, whereas most programming languages, when you have output, you output some kind of executable that does something. Well, the output of this is a graphics file, is an EPS. It's a programming language based on Knuth's MetaFont, and we'll discuss more about the history of this and the timeline in just a second. But the output is PostScript, and you can put typeset text in it. So it makes it nice to be able to have a graphic that matches up with your LaTeX. That's sort of a pet peeve of mine, is to look at documents and see all this nice, pretty LaTeX stuff, and then they throw this graphic in there that they've exported from MATLAB or Mathematica or whatever, and it just looks like it doesn't belong or something. I don't know. It's something about the fonts. When the stuff gets typeset in there, it doesn't look right. So with MetaPost, it's made for this. It's made to include typeset text. A little bit of history, and I encourage anybody that knows that I'm making a mistake here. This was hard to find this information, believe it or not. I couldn't find good information on when this stuff was. I looked all over the web, and I found some stuff, but I only found it like one place, so I couldn't confirm it or deny it. So if you see any errors here, just let me know. Tech was started being developed around 1978. I think MetaFont was developed in conjunction with Tech because Knuth had to have some kind of abilities to be able to create his fonts simultaneously. Around 1982 is when the major revisions were done with Tech. So I think he was sort of saying it's stable then. He wasn't saying that. I don't think that was the last time an error was found, a bug was found, but it was pretty stable then. All the major revisions were done by then. About a decade later, LaTeX 2.09 was released by Lamport, and then right about that same time, Hobby started working on MetaPost, or actually released his first version of MetaPost, which was done. He's at Bell Labs, and really what he did is he just took Knuth's MetaFont code, and he changed it. The syntax is essentially the same. He's essentially using the same code. He's got some modifications to be customized for the graphics, but for the most part, it's using a lot of Knuth's code for MetaFont. Now, this is what I was talking about, the graphics comparison that I'd mentioned a second ago. There are really two types of graphics. If you wanted to boil them down to two types, there are raster. That term, I like this term better than what people often call bitmaps. The reason I like raster is because bitmap kind of has a dual meaning. It means a raster graphic, but it also means a file format type in a Windows operating. That's the Windows standard version of a raster graphic is a bitmap. And so I don't usually use the bitmap. Bitmap term, but basically all in the world that is you take a grid and you take each square in that grid and you color that, you fill the whole thing a solid color. You take your digital camera, what's it doing? It's taking whatever picture it is, it's making a grid and taking every square in that grid and painting it a different color. If you use enough grid points and you use enough colors, it looks nice and smooth, and therefore we get these nice pictures. That's a raster graphic. A vector graphic is a graphic that is really drawn, filled with geometric primitives like lines and points and polygons and just different type, like I think, PostScript uses Bezier curves, so that's what MetaPost uses as well. So you're talking about geometric objects or mathematical objects used to describe the graphic. So you actually really, if you want to get down to it, you're describing the graphic, not drawing the graphic. The conversion between the two, vector to raster is easy. If you got a vector graphic and you're looking at it on your computer screen, it's rasterizing it. It's got to. It's taking this description of what the graphic is, and it's got to pixelate it. It's got to turn it into raster to display it on the screen, because after all, a screen is nothing but, like right here, and maybe it's 1024 by 768 or something. That's how many pixels are in there, and it's got to paint each pixel a certain color. So it's turning it into raster. Turning raster into vector is not so easy. You need some kind of, like if you have a drawing, if you've sketched a drawing on a piece of paper and you want to transform it into a raster graphic, you're going to need to use some like tracing tools or something. I think Adobe Illustrator has that built in. Probably a lot of your, I use a program, if I'm doing that, I'll use a program called Inkscape, which is essentially a free version of Illustrator, not nearly as powerful as Illustrator, but does a good bit of stuff. Actually, I more often than that use something called PO Trace or Auto Trace. These are free tools that are available to do all this stuff. But don't get your hopes up. Don't go out there and take a picture with your digital camera. It's like, oh, I'm going to convert it to vector graphic. That's not going to work. I mean, it's that type of graphic is meant to be a raster graphic, and you just leave it alone at that. So which is better? Well, it depends on your situation. What are you trying to do? If you're trying to take a photograph, if you want to see a natural, some kind of natural image, something that appears in nature, our eyes are going to see raster versions. So I've got natural images there. That's really not intended to be vector graphics. Those are really meant to be raster. File sizes, though, vector graphics, if they're done correctly, they have very small file size, very small. I mean, you can describe the entire image with just a very small amount of data. Raster graphics, I got a plus and a minus on that. The minus is because you're painting every pixel, it could be big, but then the plus is because you can do some compression on this stuff, on the digital data. Like, for example, you can either do lossy or lossless compression. Depending on how much you want, you can get the file size down. The resolution is the real kicker, though. If you're wanting something that you wanted to blow up a logo or something and put it on the side of this wall here, you don't want to take it with some camera, because if it's a logo that you can describe with vector graphics, do so, because it can be scaled ad infinitum. It's using vectors. I mean, if you've had a calculus course in vectors, you know that if I just scale everything by two, it just blows it up, right? So that's the biggest advantage, I would say, for vector graphics is the resolution. Common formats for these things, vector graphics, EPS, PDFs, SVG. That's a pretty relatively new one, scalable vector graphics. It's becoming more and more popular. After all, Adobe's jumped on board with it, so it must be pretty good. I didn't want to put WMF up there, not because I'm not a big Windows fan. I mean, that's true in and of itself, but that's not the reason I didn't want to put that up there. It's sort of a pseudo-vector graphics format. I won't get into the details of it, but it's kind of a, I don't want to say it's a hybrid between the two, but I don't know that it's a full-blown vector graphic either. Raster formats, your favorite BMPs, PNGs, JPEGs, GIFs, all of those, any of them that you've painted grids on there, those are the raster graphics. All right, so MetaPost fundamentals. Let's get into what we're really talking about here. Let's talk about MetaPost. The default unit of measurement in MetaPost is one big point. One big point, and there are 72 big points in an inch. So here's the idea about MetaPost. You're looking at the two-dimensional screen, like the plane or something, and every point in the plane is an ordered pair, and you're just drawing things between points in the plane. You can fill things, fill paths, fill closed paths. You can draw, you can label things. And so, but the default unit of measurement, if I said go to the point 10, it's going to go one big point, which is not very far. It's like 1/72nd of an inch. Go 1/72nd of an inch to the, my left, your right, origin, to the left or right of the origin there. And that's where it is. So it's essentially at the origin there in that case. The data types, there are 9 data types in MetaPost. the most common one in every programming language that I know of has a numeric data type. That just means that that's a number. It's just a scalar. There are pairs, since every point in the plane is an ordered pair. That's a data type. You can have a pair. Paths, if you're trying to draw some kind of curve or something, we're talking about using a path, and you can store a path that you've created into a variable and reuse it later. Transforms, if you want to do things like rotations or scalings or shifts or reflections, or reflection is just a scaling, but it's in the y direction or x direction or y direction. Colors, a color is kind of like a pair is. It's a triplet instead of a pair, but the numbers in each one of the numerics inside of the triplet are between 0 and 1. It's a triplet. Why? Because we have RGB, red, green, and blue, and those combinations will give us pretty much any color that we want. Strings, those are the things that we label, like if we're typesetting text, almost all the time that's going to be a string. Boolean. Boolean is like it is in any other programming language. It's either true or false. It's a true or false data type. Picture, if I want to store a certain picture later and redraw it or refill it or whatever, then I can store an entire picture that I've created and then reuse it later. And pen, the most common use for the pen, I mean, there are other reasons to use it, but the most common use for the pen is to change how thick the line that you're drawing is, the stroke that as you're stroking along, that's changing that. So you could actually have it change as you're going along a path. You can have it be getting smaller or bigger, but that's the most common use for the pen. Now I've got some common commands up here. Now for those of you that are interested in that know about MetaPost, don't say, hey, you forgot this one. I just put some common ones that I use. Draw and fill. Obviously, I'm going to want to draw things, and I might want to fill closed paths. I left out unfill. I didn't. That was intentional because I try not to use it. Now, there are sometimes that I have to use unfill. I don't have to, I guess, but it's just less painful if I do use unfill. But there are cases, if I can get around using unfill, I do. And I'll try to remember to elaborate on why that is later on. So there's draw arrow. Draw arrow takes a path. Whatever the path is, it takes and puts an arrowhead at the end of that path. And you can have a curved path, and the arrowhead is curved. Draw double arrow will put an arrowhead at both the head and the tail of the path, or at the start, at the beginning and the end of the path. Label, that's what I use to typeset my text. If I'm going to put some text in there, I'm going to typeset it, I'm going to use the label. And show and message are two commands that I use for debugging most of the time. So if I'm trying to show the value of something that I've done, I could do show. And when I run, like a compile something, I run impost on my figure, it'll output some stuff right there under the command line, show me the values of certain data types that I've stored in there. So those are good debugging tools there, the show and message. All right, minimal code for MetaPost. Begin fig 1, drops whatever your draw commands are that you're doing inside of there, end fig and end. Just like a, kind of like a tech doc. I'm not familiar, I just don't know much about tech, but I think it is end at the end, right? That's backslash end, right? Well, I'm sorry, bye, okay, yeah. So basically we got a similar type thing. It's end in MetaPost. It's in document in LaTeX, that's as good as I know. But you got an end, begin fig and end fig. That's like your begin document and end document in LaTeX. And then whatever you put in there, it affects whatever your output is there. That's the minimal code. If you want to put more figures in there, you can have a file that when you run MetaPost on it, you get several output graphics. And the way you enumerate them is, okay, well, you can start off with fig 1, fig 2, and keep going like that. And then you'll get two output files, and both of them will be graphics. How do you use LaTeX for your labels? Well, that's important to me because I don't really know tech, and I don't know how to do the plain tech labels. And so what you can do is you can slap this verbatim LaTeX, this percent ampersand LaTeX in there. I use document class minimal, begin document, and ETEC. That basically puts the essential stuff that it needs in there so that when you run MetaPost on this thing, it says, hey, I know I'm using LaTeX, so anytime I see a label command, I know to try to typeset it with LaTeX instead of typesetting it with tech. Notice I didn't have to put the end document down there in the end. I think it just goes ahead and does that, or else you don't need it. I should probably put it in there because it's more intuitive if you put it down at the end after all of your figures put it in, but you don't need to put it, so I didn't. All right, so typical output of the MetaPost file, if you had a begin fig 1 and a begin fig 2 like we had just now, your output's going to look like, if your source file is foo.mp, foo is the job name, mp is the extension, the MetaPost extension, the output is going to be foo.1, foo.2. Now, these foo.1 and foo.2s here, they're really just, so yeah, this is obtained by running mpost. These things are really just PostScript files, encapsulated PostScript files. They're not named .eps, but they're essentially just PostScript files, encapsulated PostScript files. Now, I said they're essentially PostScript file. They're not really standalone. If you haven't put any typeset text in there, they are standalone. If you put any typeset text in there, you're going to need something else to be able to view or do anything with these PostScript files here. And the reason is because, and this is the primary reason why I like MetaPost over anything else that I've seen, MetaPost does no typesetting. That's not what it was made for. Tech was made for the typesetting. MetaPost was made for the graphics. So if you've got labels in there and all you've done is run MetaPost on it, you're going to get out some graphics file that's not really complete yet. It's really begging to be included into a tech document. Run tech on it, and now it's complete. Okay? So they're not self-contained if you've got any labels in there. And that was a daunting task for me to really understand when I first started trying to figure out MetaPost. That was the hardest thing for me to figure out is there was this prologues thing running around. I never understood that. I couldn't find any documentation on it. Finally, I read somewhere, why don't you just include it in a tech document and compile it, and then everything will be fine. Sure enough, when I include it into tech, output the tech, ran LaTeX on it or tech or whatever, you get a DVI, convert the DVI to PS, fire it up in my PostScript viewer, and it looks just fine. It looks like it's supposed to. All right, here's where I'm going to pitch the MetaPost preview. My server was down the other day, and I got like 20 emails saying, hey, what happened to your MetaPost preview? So I know this thing is being used. We put it up onto Tug about a year ago, I don't think. But I also, I'm going to give you another pitch here. For those of you that use IRC chat, I don't know if anybody in here does or not. I personally do. There is a LaTeX room on Freenode, and I hang out in there all the time. Lots of questions and answers going on in there. That's just another, it's like Tech Hacks or comp.text.tech is another place for the impatient, I guess you could say. If you post something to comp.text.tech or Tech Hacks, it may take somebody a half a day to get to you. I mean, there's people active right there in the chat room all the time, and I help folks out, and occasionally I'll actually get some help in there. So there's another pitch. But here's my Freenode. If you put, what is it, pound LaTeX, that's the name of the chat room. There's several people in there that actually know some plain tech, too. I personally am not one of those. There's some context folks that show up in there. Lots of folks in there. It's a good group. All right, so here's my preview. We don't know enough MetaPost to try anything yet, but we'll come back to it in a minute. But this is essentially what you saw a minute ago for the LaTeX, but it's for MetaPost, and we'll look at it some more in just a minute. All right, here's my first drawing right here. I'm going to draw this line, these two line segments, by essentially saying, let's see if I can figure this thing. There's the point 0, 0. There's the point 5418. There's the point 7272. If you were to put a grid on here, that would be the origin. Coming over all the way to this this x distance right here is 72. That's 1 inch. Coming up this far is 1 inch. So this is about a fourth of an inch, and this is about 3/4 of an inch. And by drawing between these three points right here and putting the dashes between it, that draws line segments. That's all it is. Now, why the dashes? Well, dash says to connect these points with a line segment. Alternatively, you could use dots instead of dashes. Well, the dots, what they do is try to use a curve. And if you don't specify the direction of the curve, Knuth and Hobby, I think they both got it in Metafon and MetaPost, has this magic formula. I've seen the formula. It's pretty impressive, of computing what the optimal curve is, whatever that means, probably the less bend or the nicest looking, and I don't know, I'm sure they've got some measure of what the nicest looking is, but if I don't specify a direction I want any of them to go, it draws this nice smooth Bezier curve through there. It's underdetermined. You've got more degrees of freedom than you need, you have more degrees of freedom than you're using, so it's assuming some extra stuff. Now, alternatively, you could say, wait a second, at that point right there, I would like it to be going straight to the right. At this point right here, I'd like for it to be going straight up, and maybe right here I'd like it to be at a 45-degree angle. Well, that's pretty easy to do, too. You just tell it, I want it to go right here, 45-degree angle at this point, and up here, and it draws it right. Well, you can't hardly see these two, so let's change the colors in there. With color red, with color blue, now you can see which is which. All right. Basic draw command. That's probably the first thing that you're going to want to do when you're trying to play with MetaPost is learn how to draw. All right. Here's a little bit more complicated example. I'm going to draw an annulus here, or a torus, or two-dimensional torus. You think I know this. A donut, a flat donut. You squashed the donut and you made it flat. Okay. I'm going to define a path of things here, and it's an array of paths, so I'll call it P, and it's an array. I'll have a P1 and a P2. My default unit of measurement is going to be 72. That is 1 inch. This is just my own convention that I use. I don't know that I've seen other people using this convention, but maybe it is. I'm not claiming any credit for anything. This is just something I like to do. I define my unit of measurement here, and then I do everything with respect to you. So if I decide later on, hey, I want this thing really blown up by a factor of two, I just go up there and change U to 144 or whatever, and it just blows the whole graphic up by a factor of two. So full circle scale 2U. So the full circle is a built-in path in MetaPost. Now, because it's a Bezier curve, it cannot be an exact circle. Bezier curves are what? They are parametric curves where the x and the y coordinates are cubic functions of a common parameter t. You can't build trigonometric functions out of polynomials, but it's a very, very good approximation. So good that it's very hard to tell the difference. I plotted them a real circle before, and I plotted this approximation, which is full circle built into MetaPost, and it's very hard to tell the difference. Two times U. I don't know why this was done like that, but it is. When I think of a circle, I don't usually think of its diameter. I don't. I always think of its radius, but whatever. That's the way that it's built into MetaPost is you put two times. So whatever argument you give it there, when you scale something, you're really scaling it you're saying that you're scaling the whole diameter here, not the radius. So I got two times that. So this particular one, my diameter would be 144, which makes my radius 72. This one is just half of that. So I've got two circles now. Let's draw them. All right. I haven't drawn them yet. I actually filled something. Now, this is an example of why I said, here's an example of not using an unfill. What I could have done would be to fill the big circle, then unfill the little circle, and that would give me the same exact result. The reason I don't use unfill a lot of times is because if I were to convert this this graphic to, say, a scalable vector graphic, or let's say I just wanted to slap this thing on my blue background right here, I'm going to have a big white hole in there because I've now filled it with whatever my color background is here. I don't want to fill that inside. I'm really trying to avoid doing anything to the inside. So what I do is I start off with P1. P1 is a full circle. It's the outer circle. I'll just go ahead and tell you it starts right here at the rightmost edge right here, and it goes in a counterclockwise direction. That's P1. Then I'm going to do reverse P2. So P2 would start right here and go around, but I'm doing reverse, so it goes like that. But I'm connecting those two by a line segment. So I'm filling, I'm going around, and then I'm coming, and I'm going back around, and then I'm going back in. So if it wasn't as precise as it is, you would see a little dash, like a little white space or a blue space. But it's very precise, and so you don't see it. And in fact, it's not even there. Yes.
Yes,
that's right. All right, so then I draw both of the circles, so you see the difference there. All I did is drew the borders on there. Draw arrows. Okay, so I've got I just drew some arrows in there, and then I can put some labels in there. All right, So there's a basic annulus there. Just a few commands needed to do that. Here's one, a gear, and I'll show you where I use this gear in just a minute. But here's a gear that I encountered a little while back that I needed to do. How do I draw that? Well, what I decide I do, really there's two circles going on right there. There's the outer circle and there's this inner circle. So I got two circles. I take and draw three cutting lines here. I'm not actually going to be drawing these in the end. I'm just using them for guides for me. I identify, five points here. All this is done with Meta. I'm not doing this. MetaPost is doing these calculations for me. That was the hardest thing for me to grasp when I started using MetaPost. I was trying to do everything by hand. I wasn't taking advantage of the power of the programming language of MetaPost. It can do it all for you. It can compute where these paths intersect. It does all of that for you. I compute these guys. Then I basically just construct this small path right here. Once I've got that, I just tell it to draw that and draw it rotated like 16 more times or 17 more times here in a certain angle, and that's the way that I construct it. So that's how I get this path right here. Graphing functions. Obviously, this is an important part for anybody that's probably going to want to be using MetaPost. How do I just take a basic function and graph it? Well, the short answer to that is as long as the function is very, very simple, you can do it in MetaPost. But remember, MetaPost is a graphics language. It's not a numerical computation language, just like Tech is not a drawing language. It's meant for typesetting. MetaPost is meant for graphics. It's not meant for any, like, computing a bunch of numbers. That's not what it's supposed to do. It's supposed to draw things. So for very simple functions, you can do it in MetaPost, just like for very simple drawings, you could do it within LaTeX or Tech if you wanted to. But if it gets any harder than simple, you need to do something else. So what I do is I always just generate it in another program, where it's Mathematica, MATLAB, Maple, maybe it's, if you like, open source stuff, Octave, whatever. Just create it in an external program. Create a data file, then import the data file into MetaPost, and then draw it with that. So that's exactly what I say. Generate some XY data, export it, and import it into MetaPost. I've got some Mathematica, Maple, and MATLAB code. I'll put this online if y'all would like to see this. You could pull this code out and look at it. That's not really relevant here. But in order to input this stuff and use it, I'm going to use the input, the graph package that Hobby also wrote. He recognized it's going to be a pretty important thing that people are going to want. They're going to want graphs, so he wrote a graph package. First thing I do, I got this path P. I import the data with GData, and then I draw it, which is what I've done right here. I'm sorry, there wasn't enough room on my slide with all this code, so I put it up here. Now, before this next step scares you, which is a lot of code, this looks like a lot of code. A lot of this code is not necessary. It's only because I'm very particular about things. The graph package has all of this stuff where you put the labels, the tick marks, the axes. It'll do all that stuff for you. I'm just very particular. I like doing it by hand. I guess I'm a glutton for punishment. All these next commands right here is to put these axes labels on here. Okay? Yeah, once I've done one, it's just a matter of copying and pasting or whatever, changing just one little thing. But there you go. You do the same thing for the Y-coordinate. Notice, it's typeset text now. Yeah, this was typeset. I had some phantoms in here to make sure that if I had a minus on one side, I wanted a phantom of the minus on the other side so that it really lined up like that. And I don't know that I could have I don't know how easily that would have been with the graph package making it do it by itself. So I just did it by hand. Do the same thing in the Y. I've got fractions here. Throw some typeset text up in there this other is just to make sure that the center of this new graphic here, the bounding box, is symmetric around that Y-axis, so that when I throw it on a page, it really does look like, even though the graphic is not centered, the graphic will be shifted a little bit this way. But the reason is because that part from that arrow, and then there's an X over there, shifts it over just like that. So I put this other code in there to correct that. So there's this graphic right here that I created. All right, some examples. This was what I did. When I got to West Point last year, I asked somebody, hey, where's this, where is the a departmental logo? And they gave me some low-resolution raster versions, and no good. So I'm like, fine, I'll just build it myself. And it took me a little while to do it, but the reason it took me so long was the parts that took me the longest were this with the head right here, because I literally blew it up and traced it. and put nodes in there and then fit a nice little spline through it. But the one that I'm really proud of is this part right here, this laptop. And the reason is because I actually put the keys in there. I mean, I went crazy. I figured if I'm going to do it, let's just do it right, okay? So I went in there and I put the actual keys in for every one of these things. Yeah, probably went overboard, but whatever. I drew this graphic in there. This was part of an exercise that I did for a tanker that I was trying to model, modeling it as a cylinder with two hemispherical caps on the end, had some water in it. Venn diagram, I just basically have red, yellow, and blue. Obviously, intersections and complements and all that stuff. So there you go. Here's a fractal region. Because MetaPost is a programming language, you really only have to do one of these, and then you just keep copying it or just rotating it or scaling it or whatever. So that's... It makes it very easy. You can just do it all programmatically. All right, how do you include it into LaTeX? Well, a minimal LaTeX file would be document class minimal. Use package graphics. You need the graphics package to include one of these guys in there. Here's a begin document, end document. Now, I've got this package, use package if PDF. For most of you probably know what that is. It just says, if I'm using PDF LaTeX, do this. Or if my output's going to be PDF, then do this. Otherwise, don't just ignore it. Okay, so if PDF, declare graphics, and this is just something that you need to tell PDF LaTeX that this foo.1 is really a PDF graphic. That's all that's doing. So if I'm using just regular old LaTeX, then fine, it knows what to do. If I'm using PDF LaTeX, it needs this to know that I've got a PDF, that it needs to be a PDF graphic, and it'll use Hans's MP to PDF utility in the background to convert it for you on the fly while you're compiling. Conversion, MetaPost output is, and I've already said this, why it's quasi-EPS. So to convert it to PDF, I'm going to use MP to PDF, as I just said, by Hans. Convert PDF to raster is easy. I use Image Magic in Linux. I mean, it'll do those pretty easily. Convert it to SVG, scalable vector graphics. A lot of utilities will let you go straight to it. I've actually got a link here a little tool that I put together for doing this. There it is. Convert it to PDF and upload it here to this box. Hit the button and it'll send you back an SVG, because I've experimented with different forms, different methods for computing the SVG, and this has given me the best process that I've seen. I explain down here how I actually do it, to tell you the actual tools that I use and the command line arguments and all that. Okay, and so that's it.
Wow.
All right. So I don't have much time for questions, but I do have this MetaPost preview here. So if anybody wants to challenge me with something real quick, no, I'm just kidding. If you have any questions about MetaPost, maybe it's something we could run through right quick, then maybe we could try it. Yes, sir. Okay, funny you should ask that. My webpage here, down at the bottom, let's see. Here you can find some of my accumulated MetaPost documentation. That was the hardest part for me at the beginning. I couldn't find. The MetaPost manual is not meant for learning MetaPost. It's hard. It's hard. It's a good reference once you know it, but it's hard to learn it with this thing. So you go to this place. I've got several. I've got some documentations here. One of these I like put together, but it's not anything in it. It's this. But there's the graph package. There's introduction to MetaPost. Hobby wrote that. It's about a 20-page article. There's the manual, which is about 90 pages or something. There's learning by doing, which is a pretty good one, I think. It's got a lot of it. It's got a few examples. This one is really good, this examples. I'll show you why. Examples.html. It's going to take he's got loads and loads and loads and loads of examples here that he put together. So this I've got that on there. Yeah, I got my previewer, which are just list some tools that I built. Stay away from those for right now. That's not to say they're not ready. They're not well documented. I haven't done that. And then there's this tutorial thing here, which is pretty good also. It's got a very brief tutorial. It shows you how to do some stuff
there's
with it.
Page.org/metapost.
That's right.
It also has links to all of these as well as soon as I get back and Troy emails me whatever I'm missing.
Yeah.
Type by the way, slash
/MetaPost, that's right.
And it has a page of, actually, can you just bring it up?
And yes. No, I can't, because I'm not connected to the web. It looks like I am, but I'm not. I'm running a web server on this machine so that I don't have to be connected to the web. I saw the horrors yesterday of connecting and the speed and all that. I was like, I'll just run it here so I don't have to deal with that. Yes, sir. That's exactly right. And I think that's the reason Hobby didn't spend a lot of time writing these nice elaborate books on here's how you do it, because it's really meant to, if you read the MetaFont book and you understand what's going on in MetaFont, you're not going to have any trouble let me retract that. It's not going to be as much trouble as it would be if you had never read the MetaFont book. It'll be much easier. I think that's true. This thing here?
No, bring up the MetaPost preview.
Yeah.
Sure. What do you want to do? What do you want to draw?
Say DRAW. No,
it's one command, draw dot.
Draw dot?
DOT.
Okay. One comma one? How about 0, 0? I like 0, 0. I'm sure it works. There it is. You can't see it, but let's blow it up by a factor of 16 here. Hey, there it is. Okay. Yeah, so there are some intricacies in being able to convert, like as I said, about handling the fonts and making sure they're embedded. So this dot label is actually a font. I think it's probably, if I had to guess, it's actually labeled. It's either pulling bullet or it's, I don't know what it's doing. It's not bullet, but it's got to be a label. It's not some, I don't think it's a PostScript primitive. It's some label that they're putting in there. So you'd have to embed this inside of tech. And then, but this previewer does all of that for you. Okay, yeah, sorry.